Welcome everyone to the May 2021 Adoption User Group. I'm looking forward to this session. You know, Microsoft Viva, there's so much going on in that space and some really cool technology. As always, there's so much stuff that's actually new, trying to keep you up to date on sort of what's happening and what are the core features to focus on. As always, you know, one of those things that I kind of go, you know, it's a bit of a challenge. But I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians on the land on which we meet today and pay my respects to their elders past, present, and emerging. I extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders peoples here today. Code of conduct in terms of the user group, we always say, you know, we try and always be welcoming. I'm always open to any questions and or viewpoints. You can always type into chat, you know, up the top. If you click on the little chat icon, feel free to put any questions that you've got, whether it's from myself or, you know, Chris McNulty when he starts to talk very soon. That would be great. We've got also, you know, be kind and understanding. We all have differences. We all move at different paces as well. Friendly, patient, and, you know, be considerate of the type of GIFs and images that we might actually use. There's always some interesting ones that sometimes can come up. My name's Kirsty McGrath. I am an adoption consultant and director of OnPoint Solutions. You can find me online and all over the place. So keep an eye out for me wherever you need to. Normally, we'd kick off on the first Tuesday of the month, but this is me only yesterday. I was actually away. I was up in North Queensland. I was having a wonderful weekend away on Magnetic Island, North Queensland being my stomping ground. So we pushed it out by one day. But you know, all good. We'll be back to the first Tuesday of the month. And it looks like for in Sydney, we're going to be able to hold it again in person at the Microsoft Reactor. Yay! I'm just a little excited about being able to see you all again. We'll still have the online as well. So you'll be able to join online and or in person. I, you know, don't mind, you know, which it will be. We do have our speaker next month. They will be from the US, so it will be holding certain components online. But as soon as I've got that date confirmed, cross fingers, we might be able to have it in person again. Yay! All right, so what's new? Oh, as I said, it was a bit on for young and old. So a few things, and of course, the vast proportion of a lot of what we're seeing is rolling through, of course, in the Teams space. Breakout room retentions and participants reassignment is now flowing through, so you can reassign participants in the rooms even after they've actually opened, so you can start to then, you know, reassign them around, which is really great, and it will persist now over multiple sessions. So that's a new feature. Invite-only meeting options. So you can actually change it now so those settings will automatically send to those who were not originally invited by the organiser to the lobby as well. So some of the new settings there. Polls over in Teams meetings. There's some new extended, you know, capability and options that are actually coming through in this space. Some intelligence suggestions around analytics as well, and from the mobile phone too, to be able to help and support you there. So that way you can take a little bit quicker actions as you move through. So you'll see some of those, you know, poll suggestions will come up. Okay. We also have then, you know, locking the meeting so that, you know, maybe you've got someone that's, you know, popping in and out, or you're having any particular issues, or someone is unwanted, keeps trying to come in. You can actually lock the meeting and get them out. Now you can do that from the web, the desktop and your mobile, you know, those sorts of things. So it doesn't matter where they're coming in, they're actually going to be locked out, which I, you know, is going to be great. I've seen that a few times with students where they kind of go, sorry, you're going to be sort of kicked out, and a few other components like that. So, okay, what else we got? Teams, this is all meetings and webinars as well, by the way. Improvements to your audio permissions for the settings around the attendees, giving you some flexibility. They no longer need to request to speak for you to allow them to unmute. So, or you can actually have the ability to prevent them unmuting. There's external presenter support now for live events. There were some real issues in regards to allowing anonymous users who don't have the account to be presenter. That's actually changing. And the producer management for Teams live events as well. So you can have that in a separate Teams window. So you can kind of allows you to be able to do more across the, you know, across events, which is great. In the notifications, so there's now a little bit more around the Windows 10 notifications coming through. It's native inside Teams, so those sort of pop-ups, you can do that now, you know, from your desktop as well, in terms of respecting the focus assist mode that comes through on the desktop. So a couple of cool features that are flowing right down now into your Windows 10 build as well. In tasks, now I particularly love this one. So if you've got a chat or a channel post, you can actually do your right click now, and under your more actions, you've got create tasks. And in there, you can have it where it goes into the my task, and you can also add the collaborative tasks and going over into shared plans too. I love this one because there's so much that come out of sometimes a chat. So you can then go, oh, I need to do that with just a right click. Great feature as far as I'm concerned. Some of the things across mobile phone, there is a whole heap flowing through into the mobile space. Your custom backgrounds are finally hitting the iOS for Teams. Awesome. Love that. I've been waiting for that one to flow through. Then there's the Teams casting from Android and iOS. So if you are in a Teams room, and there is a ton of stuff coming through, by the way, in terms of the Teams rooms, from your, you know, whatever devices, go and have a look at the what's new in Teams. I haven't bought all those in and all the new devices, and a lot of that I leave to the technical user group, the UC and Skypes, and I'm going to be speaking at the next UC group that's based out of Sydney. So I'm going to be talking a little bit more on that particular session coming up soon. Okay, but I leave that kind of for those guys to talk a bit more. But you can cast from your mobile phone directly now to a particular, you know, broadcasting. Okay, so we've also got, let's have a look, see. In terms of the mobile, some visual updates. So the look and feel on your Teams app is actually going to be changing. So you're going to see all the mobile apps and the look and feel move around a little bit to be able to switch automatically. If you're going into dark mode on your mobile phone, it will then automatically do the switch over for you as well. Organizing your chats now in the mobile app. You know, we could do a bit of that on the desktop, but not so much from our mobile. So that's actually coming in too. So I can see, you know, we got Chris there. Hello, Chris. Kicking off very soon. Okay. I might just double check and make sure that Chris is there. My apologies because he's just flicking a message. I'm just going to invite him in. Just to make sure that he's ready to go. My apologies. He's just calling. So then emoji library and the GIFs in your mobile phone are actually getting a real extension. So there's going to be a lot more available for you to be able to play with. And then on your Android, you're going to be able to make those files accessible offline. So they'll be sitting in the files section on your app. Or usage report in terms of Teams clients. So that's actually having some more insights and metrics on a per team and across team basis. So you can actually understand sort of how people are interacting together in that particular report. And you can only have then the certain data coming through around some of that privacy as well. We have anonymous usage reports as well. Anonymizing the user data, we're protecting some of that privacy while you're viewing and downloading and sharing accessibility. Once it's enabled, the personally identified information, like his username and email address and things, are actually going to be anonymized. So it does become a little bit quieter in that particular space. Okay. Go in here. Transferring the calls between the devices. So we can get in there, and I'm just going to try again. We're just having someone who's having some difficulties. Give them a hand. Transferring the calls. Now, it was originally rolling out in March. It got put off. There is a whole heap. If you go into your message center, you'll actually see there is a ton of stuff that's got updated against it. So there's heaps that were rolling out a little earlier, Feb, March, sort of even into April, and that are now all flowing over into the May and June period timeframe. Okay, so that option to be able to join from another device or even transferring between devices is actually flowing through, which I know I do particularly love. That profile menu is having a bit of an update. It's kind of locating some of the menu links on the title. Features and functions you're going to see, it's actually going to change just a little bit. Okay. The setting your out of office now from Microsoft Teams is going to be available. You can access through, you know, your set your status message from your user profile. So that's a great one to come in, because we have got a lot of people, of course, with doing your calling and such through Teams. It's now going to be in there for you to be able to work with. Love it. What else we got? A ton of stuff on the SharePoint space, by the way. If you go and have a look at the online, so IntraZone have their updates that will flow through around what's happening in SharePoint. The core thing I was just bringing up is around the navigation. There's a new sort of modern communication team site app bar that's coming in around some global navigation, as well as being able to put other, you know, internet resources. You can customize some of that, how to actually set that up. So I've put some links in here. This is all available for you afterwards, by the way. Templates. Now, this was a bit of an update. It was going to be rolling out a little earlier. If you haven't actually seen it, it's now flowing through. It's was previously sort of mid-May. Now we're looking at around mid-June. Those templates are kind of flowing in. You can customize your own templates as well and design those and have some scripting around it, so it's actually available. Do love that, because it's got pre-populated content and web parts that your organization might actually need that would go into a site that you're rolling out. What's new in forms? So what I particularly love, and I mean, this is just an example of the word cloud, because we're not kind of seeing it just there, but coming out very, very soon, is that a word cloud for open text questions. I'll put the T in there and fix that up before I send it out. It's an AI insight. So when you go to fill in an open-ended sort of text response, a lot of times people get a little kind of go, what would I put in there? If there has been previous answers, it'll come up with just your little word cloud of different words that might actually help them with phrases to be able to kick them off and get them started. Okay. There is also update and sharing with collaborators and recipients. The share button and the way that it used to come up before was a little different. So now what they're doing is making it so that it's a little bit clearer for the forms owner and how they're actually distributing those forms to its intended audience. So you've got just the general share, but now you've got the co-author button. So the share doesn't give you the whole, what are you trying to do with share? Are you trying to do it where you're co-authoring, or you're doing it and sending it out and you're not sending the co-authoring out to all of the organization? So that came through as a required and wanted onto the roadmap in the user voice. Now, what's new in Yammer? There's a few things and plenty that's coming down the line, but the main thing at the moment is the new design for the discovery and digest of emails that are actually flowing through. So that turning off the daily sort of digest and, you know, what that looks like in the settings. So there's a couple of new ones that are actually flowing through for you to be able to update that if you need. So that's going to be, you know, rolling out on the Outlook web app and right across through to your desktop, you know, eventually coming through. But Windows, Mac, iOS, Android, all flowing through. The what's new in Office? They've been trying to fix some of the things around the built-in translator when you're receiving messages in other languages. So you can get now this sort of little prompt that will actually come up, and you can right click and translate specific words, phrases, or a whole message if you need to. The read messages with fewer distractions coming up with some of the customized texts and spaces and line. And that's all based on turning on your immersive reader, by the way. So you'll see that there's some flow through coming in that. New options around your attachment. So if you're in Outlook on the web, so this is sort of the online component at the moment, they're expanding how attachments actually look. So when you do your drop down on a document, when it comes in Outlook, what you're going to then get, the default now is going to be edit in the browser, is that new option flowing through. Okay. You've got the attachment. I've put some how-tos on the attachments and links, so you will see it just adjust just a little bit more here and there. So I'm just double checking here whether we've got Chris in. I did try calling him. I'll try again. Inviting him in. In Visio, there are some ready-made graphics for your diagrams, so you can choose from the larger library of icons and stock photo images flowing in. For Outlook and Word, dictation is now available in more languages. So if that was a challenge for you, you'll see some of those extra languages coming in. The contextual mini toolbar over in PowerPoint. So when you do a right click on something in particular, so I've done a right click on a picture, for example, down the bottom, you've got some extra features now that are coming up to be able to help and support, and across through the bottom. So you will see all these contextual mini bar changes flowing in. And then modern comments. So in that modern commenting, we are actually going to have the modern commenting team come in to speak with us. There's a whole heap that's actually flowing through in this space. Some really exciting stuff happening around sort of modern comments. So I will post that very shortly for those guys to come and have a chat with us. But it gives you, you know, a little bit of control back and consistency around this to be able to help and support you to get in. Okay. So you'll see resolving the thread, and it's going to be going right across through and into Teams as well. The what's new over in Word. So Designer is coming in for Word on the web. So it will then help you and give you some suggestions, a bit like you do in PowerPoint. So that's now flowing through. So you can access the Designer if you go to the Home tab, and you'll see Designer is now in there. So that's rolling out around about mid-June in the online to be able to support some better communication ideas. A recommendation is the Microsoft Lists. We've got that flowing through there. There's a workshop coming up for Australia. It's actually going to be on Friday at 11:30 a.m. The next month, we've actually got Lists team. The product manager from Lists is actually going to be coming in to speak with us at the beginning of June. So looking forward to that. So if you want to do the workshop that's coming up, and maybe you might have some questions specifically for them after the workshop, feel free to join us on the user group. Okay. I've kept in here from last month some of the features and functionality. If you weren't here last month, the adoption site has had some changes to the journey by role, for example. On the adoption site, it's a hub adoption is now actually available to be able to support you. There's also the champions management platform. So if you've got a champs program, then you can actually plug this into your Microsoft Teams to be able to build out your champs network. Some really great leaderboards, program management, and a digital badge to be able to support you in your journey. There's the Microsoft Community Training in an interactive demo, you know, online. It's an Azure-powered online learning platform to be able to support your organization. It's really great for low bandwidth or while offline learning if you need it. And there's some of the features around the online. Now, I'm just going to double check because Chris was having some issues with, the chat is, okay. Let me just give him the link again. Hang on a second. He's having some issues coming in. Copying the join info. Just dropping this into chat so we can in, and I'm going to flick it over in email as well. Just bear with me. Okay. Hopefully we'll have him coming back in. Yes, the recording is actually going to be available, Melina. I've got this. It's currently being recorded. You'll see that hopefully the privacy message up the top. It is recorded, and I will make this available for you after the fact. So that will be shared at the very end, everyone. So just in case you're having some issues. Anyone else? Okay. This has a different title in the actual meeting, which is... Okay, where did I get that goes. Anyone else haven't had others having issues? I've sent
Hello,
Chris, you there? Hello.
Christy.
Hi, hey, how are you? Good. Eventually still, got you still, in. Still, great to see you.
Still waiting for your email.
It's come. I flicked it through again with the join information. So cross fingers, we'll be able to get you to be able to present. I do have your presentation here if we need to potentially use it for you. Can you see in the meeting now?
I can see it on my phone. I'm just waiting to get this so I can present from my machine.
Right. We're actually in the Microsoft community tenants that get sent through. So I'm wondering if Microsoft employees are having some issues with jumping into the tenant. Hey, potentially. So I've got the get that up and running. So I have flicked through the email, just see if you've got it now to be able to come on in. I can bring up your presentation. Okay. Maybe I'll just do that. You've got it now?
Just came through.
Okay. See if you can come on in. What I'm doing is I'm pulling down your presentation for you. I can always help by flicking through if you are you able to see the screen, Chris?
I can see it on my phone. Let me just
Okay. Throw
the link that you just sent. Hang on.
Get underway. There's some, if you go and have a look online, guys, on the SharePoint site, on the tech community, for example, you're going to find that there's an awful lot in there around the what's new on tech community. There was so much. I mean, that was all very high level at the time, a good sort of quick 15 minutes of some of the things that are actually new. And there's plenty more to go in that particular space. Don't forget, we've got coming up the list product manager. So I'll just, while Chris is coming in, here we go. Chris is in. Hello, Chris. I can see you. I'll stop presenting so that you can actually hopefully take over. If not, I do have your file here and it's open now if we need to.
Christy, can you hear me?
I can indeed. We've got the double up on the audio, maybe from your mobile.
Yeah, mobile is off.
Okay, so. Sounds good now. Okay, you should be able to take over and share content.
Terrific. Let me just go back to my deck. And should be good to go.
Excellent. Yes, we can see the presentation. Awesome. Thanks, Chris.
Well, that wasn't awkward at all.
We'll let you go for it. You look terrific. Like you're in space, Chris.
Yeah, so if any of you were attending the AIM conference last week, this is the International Association for Intelligent Information Management. AIM has been one of the world's leading groups for ECM, content services, knowledge, information management. Their conference was last week. Microsoft was the lead sponsor, and one of our bits of booth swag was a series of, because they were going with a galactic theme, so we have a bunch of Viva-themed space motifs for them. So if you look over this shoulder, you'll see a little bit of the Viva iconography out there. We're working to get those available so they can be publicly downloaded. So there's one in a cockpit, one outside of a space station, and one driving a rover on a planet. So
awesome.
They're a little bit more fun than our usual ones. So anyway, great to be able to speak to you. I have not been able to make it down to Australia for the last 2 years for obvious reasons. So this is the next best thing. Look forward to being able to resume something like normal travel some point soon. So once again, my name is Chris McNulty. I am the Director of Product Marketing for Microsoft 365. I have been with Microsoft for about 6 years, having been an MVP prior as Chief Technology Officer for Dell Software, prior to when I joined Microsoft. My focus throughout my career, and especially at Microsoft, has been on content services, content management, taxonomy, and a lot of the work that we've been doing on what is now Microsoft Viva goes back 3 or 4 years to when my colleague Ian Story and I started researching ways that we could bring more value to content management in the cloud. We knew at the time, although Microsoft remained very much the leading vendor in most major analyst surveys, we knew there was a lot of headroom in what our solutions were. And so what began as an exploration of, well, let's start adding intelligent classification services and more content management and talking to customers, an increasing focus on knowledge, which has led us to Viva, which is where we are today. And I do think looking at the pivot point that we're looking at in 2021, which is hopefully for most of the world a somewhat more optimistic pivot than where we were a year ago at this time, Microsoft, I think, really has not just an opportunity, but a responsibility to do more with our solutions to help people focus on these transitions, to help make sure that we're doing everything we can to sustain people on this journey. We've been talking for years, especially in the past year. I've spoken with hundreds of customers, with analysts, looking at the data from the use of our service. And we know that the digital transformation, which has been going on for a while, has just greatly accelerated. And just when people felt like they knew how to adapt to remote work, along comes hybrid work, which is a whole set of disruptions. How do you run hybrid meetings? When people are not just working remote in one location, but truly on the go. On any given day, I might be here at home, back at my office, potentially resuming travel, or on the side of the road at a Starbucks in between. How do we take all of that disconnectedness and use it as something which can really propel us forward? We know that the data that we've been looking at shows us not just that the changes that we've seen in the past year have been disruptive, but we can expect remote and hybrid and flexible work policies to be a permanent fixture of how digital work happens. Just looking at these data, we know that leadership as well as information workers expect that flexibility to be a permanent feature of the digital landscape. And we know that what it really calls for is tremendous resilience and flexibility. Leaders want to stay connected with their entire staffs. People need to stay connected with each other, and people also need to be supported so that all of these transitions can be absorbed and used in a way that doesn't compromise things like work-life balance, that it becomes a positive, that they see that their digital workplace is something that helps them be sustained and nurtured in the course of their work. We know that organizations that focus on their people see a direct benefit in employee happiness, satisfaction, retention, customer engagement, and profitability. These stats and more really show the benefit of taking that people-centric approach. I see a note coming up in the chat. So Linda, So and we'll share the deck afterwards. So these quotes are from the Microsoft Work Trend Index that we published last month. And we have the citations for this data listed here on this slide. So these are all public record and feel free to use, consume them however you find them most. Thank you for sharing that. And so I think we all know what hybrid work is, but the fact that people are working on the at home, on the go, and in co-located spaces, they expect the same quality of experience wherever they are, and at the same time, expect the same levels of security and trust and compliance, whether they are parked on the edge of a highway, whether they're inside of a data center, or they are working from a countertop alongside their school children. So with all of that digital work, we really think it's important to remember that for us, the core focus for how digital work gets done for us is Microsoft Teams, what Gartner would call the digital work nucleus of the modern employment environment. So we all know that Teams rolls up capabilities for collaboration and calls and meetings and chat, as well as providing an infrastructure to deploy applications or to extend that experience. So as the hub for where digital work gets done, and with a focus on what people are doing, it really drives us to understand, what do we need to add into that Teams platform to create a great employee experience? And so the research that we commissioned with our colleagues at LinkedIn focuses on these six major attributes for what employee experience means. Do people feel safe physically and emotionally in their workplace? Do they have the opportunity to make and sustain high quality relationships with leaders, with peers, with staff, as well as people outside of the organization who have shared stakeholdership? Are there tools to let people understand what is a priority, what to work on, and get feedback on how they're doing? Do people feel access to the right kinds of data and knowledge and information to make decisions and take the right actions? Are people being sustained and lifted up to acquire new skills and learning in the flow of work? And finally, are there cultural systems that help people understand a shared set of values and goals that permeates an entire organization? And so from our perspective, where Microsoft enters is, we've observed these trends and we think we have something to contribute. And what we think that we can add to that discussion of employee experience, which is central to digital transformation, is creating a system that we call a digital employee experience platform, or an EXP. Employee experience is not a new concept. And for those of you who are in or connected, particularly to HR organizations, employee experience has been top of mind for years. And many of our partners have solutions in the market already. And when we think about all of the things on this screen and beyond, which surround an employee, we know that there's great opportunity to be able to connect all of those. We hear three things when we talk to our customers. First, leaders know that employee experience matters. Employees are eager to be able to enrich the flow of their digital work in a hybrid environment with tools like these. And IT is really not interested in yet another rip and replace motion. Many of these solutions that are out there today, alongside what Microsoft has developed, alongside solutions you may have in place, are wonderful, but they take people out of the flow of work. I know even at Microsoft, for us historically, learning is something that happens when we get an annual or quarterly reminder about required training, when we have to go figure out where is the learning portal so I can go in, find the right classes, et cetera. And those problems of finding those employee experiences are exacerbated when people are on mobile devices, when they're on their phone, when you've got to surf a sea of rarely used mobile applications, just trying to find the right piece of information. So what we think we can bring, building on top of the Teams platform, is a connected set of experiences that brings these other environments into the flow of work through Microsoft Teams. And so for us, initially with Microsoft Viva, there are four major attributes to what we're doing. We're focusing Microsoft Viva on tools to help shape and form organizational culture, to give people coaching and guidance to help sustain their well-being, both for individuals as well as collective teams, tools to deliver knowledge from others to people in the flow of their work, as well as systems to help people engage with the learning and skills that they need to advance in their careers. And so Microsoft Viva includes these four modules to address those experiences: connections, insights, topics, learning. Each is based on Microsoft 365. Each is derived from the Microsoft Graph. And each, as you can see, is intended and gives the best experience right through Microsoft Teams. So in many ways, we think of Viva as being Teams plus plus, as a way to build on top of those great experiences that people have been using the last several years with Teams and be able to extend that in the place where people are increasingly spending more and more and more of their digital work lives. So I'll talk about each of the sections of Viva here in turn in just a minute, but I think it's important to focus on a couple of key attributes about Viva itself. Hang on, just jumped funny here. First and foremost, it is a system of organization that brings employee experiences into Teams. And in doing that, people are the organizing unit. We want to deliver experiences that are great for individuals. And in making those great experiences, we're leveraging the graph to be able to derive insights about what makes the most sense in the most context to deliver personalized experiences for individuals as well as for groups. It lives into the Microsoft 365 trust boundary, so all of the security, privacy, and compliance policies that you've established are going to be sustained through this new set of experiences. And most importantly, it is an open platform with a broad ecosystem of solutions today that we're going to continue to invest in the months to come. Just for the launch this year, this is a sampling of some of the partners and members of our ecosystem that we are integrating into Viva today. And you can see they span the gamut from traditional integration firms to organizations that deliver learning management systems to workflows, CRM, communications, content integrations, and more. This is just a starting point. We have a lot more coming throughout the year, more partnerships to announce, more APIs to let more of our partners build their integrations, and to allow each of you to build your own integrations to systems that you may not see already mentioned with an existing partner. So that's Viva in a nutshell. And in just a moment, I'm going to walk you through kind of a high-level envisioning demo of how Microsoft Viva works. And we can stop for a few questions, and then we'll go through each of the modules in a little bit of detail. So let's take a look at Viva in action. Come on up. Video does not want to play.
Let's always give it a chance, isn't it?
One second, let me close something down here. Signs of progress.
Microsoft Viva empowers people and teams to be their best by bringing communications, insights, learning, and knowledge into an integrated employee experience right inside Microsoft Teams. Viva Connections is your gateway to this experience, allowing you to stay engaged and informed no matter where you work. Here's an example for a company called ReliCloud. Connections is customized for your organization and personalized for you. with a feed of relevant news, announcements, and conversations so you're always in the know, and a dashboard connecting you to company resources and tools from Viva and across your digital workplace. You can tailor Viva connections for every role, from frontline workers to executives, to keep everyone connected and engaged. Viva Insights helps you work smarter and thrive with personalized reminders to prioritize time for focused work, coaching, and learning. Take regular breaks and mindfully wrap up your workday with a virtual commute. For managers and leaders, Viva provides insights and recommendations to foster healthy, successful teams and build personal and organizational resilience. For example, Viva can help a manager see if a team is at risk of burnout, then take action to help them develop healthy work habits and feel balanced. It helps you understand the impact of work patterns and the business, then drive and measure change while protecting personal privacy every step of the way. With Viva, you can foster success and well-being for you, your team, and your organization. Viva Learning brings all your learning resources together in one place. You'll find content that's been assigned to you and recommended from a variety of sources, including your own custom content, learning management systems, and top content providers, including LinkedIn Learning and Microsoft Learn. With Viva, learning becomes a natural part of your day and lets everyone learn in the flow of work. It's easy to find, share, and discuss learning, and organize resources to foster a learning culture. Managers can assign learning and track completion to accelerate onboarding. Viva Learning enables employees to develop their skills and grow in their careers and as a person. Lots of learning is done on the job, and Viva Topics magically connects you to knowledge and experts. When you come across an unfamiliar topic or acronym, just hover. No need to search for knowledge. Knowledge finds you. Want to know more? Just click to find people, resources, and conversations related to the topic. Have a question? Just ask. Viva has the answer or calls in topic experts. Viva uses AI to build topic pages automatically and makes sure sensitive content remains protected. With Viva Topics, you can harness the knowledge of your organization and connect people to that knowledge in the apps they use every day. These features and more are coming to Microsoft Viva this year. Microsoft Viva brings communications, insights, learning, and knowledge together into an integrated employee experience so everyone can be their best and the whole organization can thrive.
Okay, so I'm happy to talk about each of the modules of Viva, but I can also pause here. I know there's been a couple of things in the chat. Would love to just, ask the audience, so far based on what you've seen, like which of those modules, if you had a magic button to turn it on in your own environment, would you be most interested in having for yourself? So I see Linda has a question. Some comments coming in. So when can we try it? We'll talk a little bit about roadmap, but right now Viva Topics and Syntex are both in commercial release. And you can also sign up for a free trial of each of those. Viva Connections is available for all M365 plans that include SharePoint at no additional charge. And both insights and learning are in public preview right now. The public preview for learning is currently oversubscribed, so it's taking us a little bit of time to clear the backlog, but that is where we stand right now. There's votes for learning, votes for insights, learning. I see a note from Anton that you signed up for the learning trial but got no response. Learning is not yet at commercial release. So when you sign up for a learning trial, basically our engineers have to manually turn it on for each organization. So there's a huge backlog Once something gets to commercial release, it's one of the things that that means is it's very easy for us to use our commerce engine to turn things on or turn things off, which is why it's, you know, we have thousands and thousands and thousands of topic trials and topic production out in the world right now. Awesome.
We've also got one saying, like to see if it's a good fit for training EUs.
So could you expand? I'm not familiar with that particular acronym.
Thomas? End users?
Well, end users.
Yes.
You know, that's a great subject. Let's hop around. You know, I'm not just going to march through my deck in initial order. Let's talk about learning, because there seems to be some questions about that. So some of the core philosophies that led us to create learning and to shape it the way we've shaped it are looking at this gap. 3/4 of CEOs see skills and training as being the essential ingredient to driving growth. And we know from things like our Work Trend Index that more than half of the employees that we've surveyed would stay at a company longer if they knew it was investing in their skills. But less than 1% of people's work time is spent acquiring those skills. Why? Simply put, it's too hard to find them. And so that's the core philosophy for us with Viva Learning. We want to bring learning into the flow of work as something that's part of people's digital lives. And so Viva Learning is a system that's based on the Microsoft Graph that allows us to distribute learning courseware that can come from places like Microsoft with MS Learn and LinkedIn Learning, third-party providers like Coursera, edX, Skillsoft, and Pluralsight, systems from learning management providers, as well as your own content. And so to get to your question about individual users, the way that we see learning working is it can include things that are in your, I'd say, casual course catalog. What might that be? It could be a PowerPoint, a PDF, a video. These are tools and resources that you can distribute through traditional means. You can put them on a SharePoint site. You can link to them through Teams. But Viva Learning can consume those and integrate those alongside the rest of the courses that you make available to people. So you don't necessarily need to wait for Pluralsight to build a new course to match what your employees need. If you have a video or a PowerPoint, you can use Viva Learning to distribute it. So I want to kind of walk through this in a little bit more detail. So one of the key ways that we see Viva Learning landing is at the team level. So here inside of my team that's working on Project SOAR, I'm in this channel. And if I want to add a new tab, I can add a new tab for Viva Learning. And I'm going to give it a name, because it's for my SOAR project, but I don't have any courses. So I can search the catalog of what's already published. So here I'm going to look for courses that involve leadership. So I'm going to select these and a couple more, and I can save those, and it'll set the tab up. And now people in my team, regardless of whether they're coming in through desktop or mobile, have a way of getting to these courses. And if I see something else that I want to add, I can browse the catalog, find another course, and it shows up here. So I know this is mostly an adoption user group, but I also want to talk a little bit. Learning has some technical magic behind the scenes, but configuring it, we think, is going to be relatively simple for most organizations. So here, I'm going to take a look at the admin experience. Oh, sorry. Once that class is there, meant to mention, I can see it in the catalog. I can also see, based on the signals in the graph, what I interact with, the subjects that I follow, the content that I write. Viva Learning will make intelligent suggestions about other classes that I might want to pay attention to. And those are all coming from the catalog. So as an adoption class, I don't usually jump over into the admin center, but a little bit about how relatively simple it is to set up learning catalogs. So here you can see out of the box, Viva Learning is including links out to LinkedIn Learning, to Microsoft Learn, and to M365 training. And if I wanted to add classes from Coursera, edX, Pluralsight, and Skillsoft, if I'm subscribed to those, I can click on those and add those as sources that pull into my catalog. I can also add what you'll see here, SharePoint, as a source. And a SharePoint source is really a customized list. It's a catalog. If you know how to add items to a list, you know how to add items to the catalog. And it's one central place where you can configure where with links that point out to those PDFs or videos or PowerPoints or any other resources that you may have to make them show up alongside the other courses that Viva Learning is distributing. And so that learning, as we noted before, I can see things that have been assigned to me in learning management systems, things that the graph is suggesting for me based on what I'm doing. And you can see we've got some videos that are coming from my team and some PDFs, as well as courses from places like Skillsoft, Pluralsight, Coursera, edX, and a variety of Microsoft sources. One thing that I want to make clear is that Viva Learning is a discovery and distribution engine. What it is not is a learning management system. So it interfaces with systems like Cornerstone On Demand, SAP SuccessFactors, Saba, and the rest to be able to see, are there required courses that someone has structured for employees? It will allow those courses to be shown to people through Viva Learning, and as people finish them, it will register those back in. So we are working really closely with those partners, and there'll be more to come as we're going along. We've been in private preview for several months here on Viva Learning, and one feature that has come in through suggestion isn't just taking a look at my learning, but how do we make learning even more social? So I can come here and I can find a class that I want to launch and launch it inside of Teams and get that experience. And again, staying inside of that digital work hub. And if I like that class, I can jump over into chat and I can add it into a chat. And this is a feature that was suggested by our preview customers and they seem to really like it. So I can just come here and say, I want to take a particular course and I want to add it into chat. We'll generate an adaptive card for it. And I can add this to a one-on-one or to a team chat just to make sure that, you know, we're taking advantage of all the ways that we can use Viva Learning to be able to distribute courses for people through the flow of their work. So a little quick tour of where we were on Viva Learning. I hope that addressed that question.
We had a question just around the course completion, the content data stored and queried by Power BI. Is it, you know, SQL, Dataverse, other? But I think you kind of explained that saying it sits wherever it is you've pulled it from, like Pluralsight or LinkedIn Learning or the platform that you're using, for example.
Yeah, it interfaces with that. That's typically the authoritative source. We are logging when people are launching a class through Viva Learning. There will be APIs that you can use to go interrogate that information shortly after we go to GA for Viva Learning this summer.
We also had a question in regards to Viva and how Viva and My Analytics actually interact with each other.
So let's talk about insights a little bit so we can get some context around that. So Viva Insights, the second module we'll talk about tonight, is based on our investments in tools like My Analytics, Workplace Analytics, and Glint. And for us, Insights is really looking at these two divergent trends. Or maybe they make sense if you've been through the past 15 months. Work demands have skyrocketed and burnout and well-being are becoming top of mind issues from the front line to the boardroom. And what we see going on with Viva Learning is being able to use privacy protected data to help people get coaching at individual, team, and organization level about what's happening in the workforce or what's happening in your individual schedule and helping make sure that people are protecting capacity, that avoiding burnout, making sure that they're protecting their relationships, and whether those are relationships with colleagues or with themselves for personal time. So my analytics, which is the personal side of Viva Insights, has a common source of information, which for us is the Microsoft Graph. So inside of, right now I'm seeing that personal experience of Viva Insights delivered inside Teams. And I can also see that parallel experience here on the right about what I'm seeing if I go into the mobile experience. And I can see reminders to stay connected with people, coaching about places where it looks like I have conflicts, or reminders to protect time for focus, for email, and for learning. And so in addition, I can get reminders to make sure I'm protecting focus time through the app, as well as protecting personal time with what we're calling the virtual commute. So virtual commute is entirely optional. You can turn it on demand, or you can pivot to have it run on a scheduled basis every day. And the idea of a virtual commute is to have a structured way to wrap up work so that you can take time for yourself whenever that happens in the course of the flow of your work, and then be able to start the next work day better prepared without allowing work to drag into the evening and later and later and later. So the idea of a virtual commute is when it's time to start it, you get a reminder to check in on your open tasks, marking what's been finished or what should be carried over as a reminder for the next day, with an opportunity to remind you what's coming up tomorrow, checking in with how you feel about the day, and also giving you an opportunity to take a moment for some reflection using our integrations with a set of prepackaged included meditations or quiet time with our partnership with Headspace. And so in addition to all that, the personal experience of Viva Insights that you can see here is based on the graph. And so on the home screen for personal insights inside of Viva, you can see a summary of all of those things that you're doing. How are you feeling? And we can see reminders showing up there. And here's coming in from LinkedIn Learning. This LinkedIn Learning class is being shown to me because it is either a suggested or a required course that we know that I need to take. And so Viva Insights is giving me the opportunity here to know that it's coming up and to remind me to put a placeholder for it on my calendar before my day gets filled up with the meetings that seem to take us increasingly from dawn to dusk. Viva Insights is also closely tied to our, what we call the briefing email from Cortana, which gives you a summary of the week and a reminder to protect that focus time, training time, one-on-one time on a weekly basis. That's currently available in English and Spanish. Later this year, we'll be extending support to French, German, Italian, and Portuguese. At larger levels, the personal insights are yours and yours alone. People can't get to your individual data there. There's no reports that we do that show names. We depersonalize the data and we let teams and organizations look at trends happening throughout the organization. So here I can see that an increasing amount of my workforce is working after hours and working after hours a lot, that people are also responding to messages and meetings throughout. So we know that, you know, a pattern like employee burnout is something that I might want to pay attention to. So as a manager, I can take a look at that data in more detail and see a recommended plan to help my team know that it's okay to stop working at the end of the workday, with reminders to turn off notifications, to revisit priorities daily, to know that it's okay to decline after hours meetings, and then to understand what my team is doing after hours. Is it meetings? Is it email? Is it IM? Is it after hours calls? And you can take the data here directly from the signals in the Microsoft Graph. You can also integrate collaboration data, if you have information coming in from places like Slack and Zoom, to be able to construct a holistic picture of how your team and how your organization are working. At that org level, I can also look at high level data showing only 37% of my teams are strongly connected to each other. That means that my org as a whole is at high risk of isolation. And again, at the org level, I can take a look at best practices about making sure people are at least using videos for FaceTime, making sure that people have an opportunity to protect their personal time with my analytics, and seeing, in this case, the Teams has not been widely deployed, a reminder that people can stay more connected to each other through practices like those. Finally, we really think that with Viva Insights, there are some powerful understandings that you can derive when you mix that collaboration and workforce data with information coming from other sources, like line of business data or employee listening tools like Glint. So on the left, we can see that there's a broad range of opinions about, does ReliCloud care about my well-being? And we see individual contributors feel most strongly about it, along with top leadership, SVP. But managers are at a different level. And by taking a look at that feedback data and mapping it against how many hours a week people are spending on average in meetings, we can see that there's a correlation between how much meeting time someone spends and how little they think the organization cares about their well-being. We've seen other organizations use this data with things like sales data and sales analysis. EY, for example, did an analysis that found out that, you know, the top 20% of their sales force spent 12 hours a week in direct customer communication. Everyone else spent 9. Now, correlation is not causation, but it really drove home for that customer the importance of protecting time so that people can engage in those kind of high quality communications. So that's kind of a quick walkthrough on Viva Insights, and I can kind of pause and see what questions there are there.
We had one, Chris, that was around, you know, the virtual commute and insights, you know, when would we actually see that flowing through? They said it seems amazing.
Yeah, so virtual commute is rolling out this quarter to customer. If your company has enabled the personal insights piece of Viva Insights is available to all M365 customers. And so virtual commute is rolling out now. It's just a matter of has IT enabled it or not.
Great. I've just put in there that if you need my analytics, workplace analytics, for example, speak with your Microsoft account manager and they can help you in that space.
Yep. So I want to just, I know that we are a little short on time, but I want to just very quickly spend a moment or two talking through topics and connections.
That's fine. Look, anyone that may need to drop off, we will have it recorded for you to be able to come back and catch up. Appreciate you joining in. Everyone that wants to stay, we can continue on. That's fine, Chris. No hurry.
So we know that it's important for people to be integrated with each other, to have those high quality relationships. And as we pivot from remote work to hybrid work, we know a lot of those cultural tools are going to look very different moving forward. We may never gather an entire department or division into the same room for a town hall or an employee social. And so we know that sustaining those connections, being able to orchestrate a culture, is super important. So Viva Connections, like the rest of Viva, based on Microsoft 365 in the graph, integrates tools from SharePoint, Yammer, and Stream to be able to deliver a company-branded application inside of Teams that is tailored to individual roles with targeted communication and resources, as well as adapting from mobile to tablet to desktop, so that regardless of role and regardless of how you're interacting, there's a role in this for you. One thing I think is super important is when you hear Microsoft marketing talk about, we've got boardroom, we have information worker, and we have first line workers. The way it is shaking out, especially in 2021 and beyond, is in the course of most people's workday, you're a frontline worker and you're an information worker. And we want you to make decisions and act like an executive. So all of these tools are really multilateral ways of making sure that people can find the things that they need and the people that they need to do them with. So Viva Connections, just very quickly, you'll see here I'm launching for Rela Cloud, a branded targeted application for employees. It integrates news, feeds of information, as well as dashboards for things that I need to pay attention to. And those communications and resources are extended into a mobile form factor. So I can see a live feed of activity going on around the organization. And I can take a look at what's happening. And if I'm on mobile, I can see the same kinds and quality of information that I'd be getting to through traditional desktop teams. So just to focus on that, I can see a great experience that looks good. So I can participate and see what these updates are, scroll through it, and then be able to participate in communications by adding my own comments, even though I'm on a mobile device. So that feed of information is orchestrated from the content that you work on and from community posts in tools like Yammer, as well as news updates coming from across SharePoint. So it provides that continuous, targeted, updated stream of information that I need to pay attention to stay in the flow of knowledge in my organization. And I can, you know, go elsewhere and be able to keep track of the latest news, the latest events, the latest announcements. But the thing that we're really excited about is what we're doing with what we're calling the dashboard. And so if I take a look at the dashboard here, you'll see I'm getting to see the things that I need to pay attention to on a daily basis, whether they relate to benefits, managing time off, health checks, tasks that require completion or approval. And you can extend the dashboard using our dashboard framework to be able to structure adaptive cards to show me information coming from inside Microsoft 365 as well as beyond. We've made it really easy to be able to integrate documents as well as data feeds from line of business systems, things you know like customer relationship systems or other providers that exist around the organization. And I can get to that dashboard both in mobile form factors as well as desktop. The dashboard is also a great place. We really see connections as being the springboard to take you into the rest of Viva. So here, going around the dashboard, I can see reminders to be able to take a break or what learning is pending for me. Because by bringing all this information into the graph, we can then personalize that experience regardless of which part of Viva and Microsoft 365 I'm staying engaged with. Anyway, so that is a quick tour of connections. And the last thing I want to talk about in the interest of time, I'm going to cut this a little short, is Viva Topics. So I'll skip the videos that we have and I'll skip some of the overall architecture, but for us, Viva Topics is something I've been working on for 4 years, and we think it's really magical. Viva Topics uses AI to operate against information that lives inside of your cloud and the signals that we get in the graph to be able to identify candidate subjects, or what we call them suggested topics. And when we find, when the software finds a topic, it builds a topic page and suggests the experts who should be in charge of that topic. Nothing gets shown to people until they are reviewed, curated, and approved, but where that topic page acts as the first draft of your shared knowledge, and experts then add this information to make it better. And then that information gets distributed to people throughout the apps they use every day in places like Teams, SharePoint, Outlook, Yammer, and the Office clients. So here I'm beginning inside of Teams. And in this case, on my inside of my Northwind Trading Group, I see a reference to an acronym I'm not familiar with, Project SOAR. And if I just hover over that, I'll see the topic card. Now, this is a capsule summary of everything that I might want to know about SOAR. I can see that it's a project. I can see alternate names for it, definitions and sources, key people, as well as resources coming both from inside of my cloud, as well as information that's connected from outside of my cloud. Here, seeing an article coming in from ServiceNow that I've connected to using my graph-based content connectors. I didn't have to run a search. I didn't change application. The knowledge just found me in the flow of my work. And so without having to waste time looking up prime resources, I have everything I need in context to understand that. But if I have more questions, if I tap on a card, I bring up the topic page. And as you may have noticed before, the topic page gives me even more screen real estate. So I can see definitions, experts, suggested people I might want to be able to work with, an extensive set of suggested resources for me to pay attention to, questions and answers that are surfaced from around the organization with known open questions and answers, related topics. And if I have another question, I can pose it here. If Viva Topics knows the answer, it gives it. If it doesn't, it uses natural language processing as well as its graph signals to know which experts to ask. And when they provide an answer that I've accepted, it gets added to everyone's shared knowledge. So over time, as Viva Topics gets smarter, everyone benefits. So Viva Topics is available now. You can get to it inside of SharePoint through Microsoft Search. We'll be bringing it out into Teams in the second half of the year. And one of the things that we'll be bringing it out for is inside of the Topic Center. So the Topic Center is a place where I, as an individual, can see the topical information that is going to make the most sense for me. News, content, recommendations, training, all based on the subjects I follow, all based on the signals that we get from the graph to show me what's going to mean the most to me today. If I'm a knowledge manager, the Topic Center is also where I can come to manage the flow of topics. Topics begin as suggestions. They need to be confirmed before they can be published. I can see the run rate of topics in my organization, as well as metadata about which topics are getting the most or least impressions. This graphic, by the way, is a little bit out of date. We are about to release some new funk. We already are showing quality scores on topics and are soon going to add additional metadata to show me missed impressions. Those are places where we had knowledge, but because someone wasn't licensed, they didn't get to see those. So we want to make sure people understand all the ways that they can pay attention to the right topics to shape the flow of knowledge to people throughout the organization. Topics is also closely related to its cousin from Project Cortex, SharePoint Syntex. I'm not going to walk through a Syntex demo tonight because of time, but Syntex helps uncover the knowledge that lives inside documents. Basically, one person who understands a kind of document uses a visual tagger to go through and say, this looks like a purchase order, this looks like a contract, and then to draw inside of the document where the key information is that I want to pull out. Facts, figures, people, locations, summaries, all that and more come out as rich metadata tags. Syntex also will lay down automatic security and compliance policy, making the content that it works with a much richer source of information that Viva Topic can then use to prepare topic pages and topic cards. So that's a very quick tour of what we're doing with Viva Insights. I wanted to just drop down and share with you just a couple of details and where we are in the roadmap. Last year, we, in addition to some of the things that we announced about my analytics, workplace analytics, and virtual commute, our first piece of this, Syntex, went to general availability last fall, at least for us in the Northern Hemisphere, last spring for you all. At our launch event back in February, topics went to general availability. We moved into previews on most of the rest of Viva. Connections desktop went into general availability in March. By summer, the very simple answer is all of Viva will reach general availability in Northern Hemisphere summer or winter for you, along with additional public APIs moving from preview into public availability later this calendar year. There's a lot more that we can share, and one of the best places to stay in touch with us is through our newsletter at aka.ms/viva/join. If you sign up there, you'll get a monthly email update from us about what's new and what's upcoming inside of Viva. You can join us at microsoft.com/viva to learn more, to get to our resource centers, which open up additional demos, white papers, videos, training, and more. And, you know, Microsoft, along with our partners, you know, are ready to help you take the next step in this journey. So I will, you know, I've been talking a lot at you. I'm happy to take any questions from any folks we still have here on the line.
Feel free to type or mute. Give everyone a chance.
Hey, Kirsty, Roland here. How are we going?
Hi, Roland. Good.
Good, good. Hey, Chris. I might have missed it, but costings and whether Viva is going to be available on CSP or EA. Like, I know that the stuff I've read, they said that they will announce the costings of the Viva components and add-ins as they are released. But do you have any insights into that at the moment?
I may have a few more than I can share right now, but I can probably give you enough broad strokes to get you helpful. First, Viva Topics as well as Syntex as the first pieces to become available, kind of give you some understanding of what to expect as each module comes out. So Viva Topics initial list price is $5 per user per month. That is the US price. The actual discounted price that's available when you transact it is always substantially less than that. But it's a per user per month price. Each of the modules will have a specific price for their premium features. Connections today doesn't have any premium features, so there's no additional charge available with that. Okay. Insights, if you have the Workplace Analytics license, that will become the Viva Insights license. Learning is not yet GA, will have its own user license. Viva Topics is available for EA and for CSP today, and each of the modules, as they become fully transactable, will also be on CSP as well as EA.
Okay, but a freemium version, a lightweight version, will possibly be available with some of the E5 licenses currently? Yes, no?
Yes, and the timing of that, I mean, it's a fair question. For instance, right now, Viva Topics is all premium. And we are doing some design work today even to figure out what would a lightweight topic card look like. And it could be, you know, we're looking at all sorts of options. It could be that it's manual. It could be you get to see three topic cards a month, and after that it has to be paid. There's nothing that we're ready to commit to yet. But there will be some baseline value for Viva Topics. For insights, personal insights are something that's going to be broadly available through M365. The team and organizational insights will be premium. For learning, we haven't determined what the mix of, we have to be at general availability before we can say what might be broadly distributed and what would be a premium license. I have some colleagues who like to say it's free. We know our customers are paying a nice sum of money to be able to license Microsoft 365. So I hate saying, oh, you're gonna get it free. It's coming, there will be pieces of it that come in Microsoft 365 and other pieces that you have to pay more for. Connections desktop and mobile, that is seated value. We envision doing some other things down the road that may be premium on top of connections, but those aren't designed and we can't really disclose what those will be. So I see Chin and Sam are having a discussion I don't disagree with. Does Viva spell the end of what we know as the traditional internet? Depends on your sense of tradition. I think it is the next phase. You know, in many ways, if you think about Teams, for us, Teams is sort of an alternative browser. And if you think back to what I said before, it's hard enough to keep track of all the different internal URLs that you might need to use in a typical company to submit an expense report or to pay a vendor or to take a learning class. And if I then decompose each of those URLs into the mobile life, where each is an individual tool, that's just a lot of different places to go, and I can't do it. The advantage of Viva Connections, by being able to integrate from the rest of Viva, from the rest of what you might think of as your traditional intranet, is it's a launch pad for those things. Right now at Microsoft, the root of our intranet is something we call MSW. We've called it that for years, Microsoft at Work. It began life as SharePoint 2003 server on-premises environment. It has grown and shifted and migrated and upgraded. It runs at the root of our SharePoint environment. It is not the only system we have. We have lots of portals around the company for things like legal, HR, learning, finance, et cetera. And all of those systems are connected back into MSW, and MSW is the basis for what Connections is for us as employees at Microsoft. And so it flows into Teams, so it takes advantage of Teams navigation to the rest of it and make sure that I can get a really good experience inside Teams, regardless of whether I'm on my phone right here. Oh, I love what it's doing. The Teams background is making my phone invisible. There it is. Or on my desktop or on my tablet. So Christy, I want to just adjust that. Technically speaking, you don't need a hub site to connect into Connections.
Okay. Because all you need is a, you need to set up, have that hub site to come in to
it connect
up and yeah.
It is strongly recommended, but the base level requirement is that you have a modern site, probably a communication site.
Yep.
If you have Yammer and Stream on it, great. It'll pull those through. If you don't, yep, it'll still work. It doesn't even need to be a site that's at the root of your intranet. It needs to be modern. It needs to be a modern site. And it doesn't need to be a hub. And today there's a PowerShell command that you run,
yep,
to register that place as the launch point for the app inside of Teams.
Right, because you're going it was sort of saying in the instructions, going through, make sure you have a hub site. So it's like, okay, righto then, we're working our way through. So good to get that clarified.
Oh, it's better if it's a hub site, but yeah, if you haven't moved hub sites, you can still use Connections.
Yeah,
Connections today is Connections Desktop. So Connections Desktop does not have the dashboard. It has an earlier version of the feed, which is going to get revamped in summer. So the dashboard and the mobile app for Connections, those will ship in, I'll translate for all my buddies down in Melbourne, early winter.
Okay. Yeah, so we're a little after lunchtime here for your evening. Do we have any other questions? If not, we'll finalize and wind up. I'll just give you the last few things that we've got going on here. Let me just come back just to keep going. And if there are any other questions, please feel free to type them in and we'll get Chris to So I put in the presentation that I've actually flicked through in the chat already. Yeah, so you've got that in here, the link to the deck where you can find more information in regards to Chris or connecting with him online, a little bit about sort of Viva and the information that's there. I've also put links in the chat for you to all those various topics, you know, depending on, you know, what it is that you're wanting to sort of deep dive in terms of connections and the likes. There's also some other really great resources online. There was a panel recently by some of the MVP community out there around Viva, which was a, you know, a great, great one to go and have a watch. And there's lots of really cool stuff out there to be able to help and support you, including the YouTube videos and the likes there. In terms of moving forward, I've got all the sort of standard links in here and where you're actually going to find some of the resources that are out there to support you as an adoption and change community, whether you're training or product managers, whatever that looks like. How do I actually stay on top of a lot of the latest information? I'm putting in some of the links here for you to be able to find it yourself. Other user groups that we've got locally. We've also got a list there of all things Australia and New Zealand across the top as a link. You can find us online all over the place to be able to support you. I will provide this recording for you. What's next? We're going to have Andrea Lum coming in and talking with us about Microsoft lists and how we sort of track and manage information with those Microsoft lists. So I look forward to Andrea coming in. And just finalizing also having, as I said, the team coming in around modern commenting. And so I'm looking forward to having that one up and running for you. Any other thoughts and questions? Happy for you to unmute or type them into chat for me. Otherwise, until next time, thanks, everyone. And a special thanks for Chris for coming in and persevering, getting online, and cross fingers we won't have those issues moving forward. It's been a first on the user group. Any other questions, anyone? If not, we'll see you next time.
Cheers, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chris. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Cheers. Thank you, everyone that's stayed on. I'll stop the recording.